Founder of Rouge. We are about 4 years, almost 4 years old now. Team of 11, sitting out of Mumbai, passionate in gaming. Our idea was to create a startup. I used to work at Disney and India Games before that. Rouge is a new beginning, and it's all about making some cool games. That's how we started about it. Just a show of hands, how many of you guys have worked on Unity? Every single one, that's awesome. How many of you guys have shipped a 3D game in Unity? Okay, awesome, awesome, awesome. So this talk is going to be about a game called Zombie Blocks. How many of you guys have played Zombie Blocks on the show floor? Awesome. So we'll be even demoing it today as well. After this talk, I'll be going and setting it up. So if you didn't have a chance to play it yesterday, please do check it out. This talk is going to be all about that. I'm going to keep it little, since everyone is Unity. So the idea is to share some of the insights on how we made the game. I'll show you guys how to little bit about the structuring of the project as well, how we went about doing it. So let's start. So the game, the topic is simple, getting hundreds of zombies to chase you. There are literally hundreds of zombies in the game, and it runs flawlessly on most of these devices. So our challenge is what we learned. That's what is going to be shared. So the game is Zombie Blocks. It's going to be released next week. November 15th is the date we have got. We just submitted Gold Build yesterday. So it's an arcade action game, a lot of zombies to kill in. I'll just run a small trailer just to show you guys what the game is about. I don't know whether it'll go full screen, and it does. Do we have audio? Yeah, on. Oh, that's what happened. So I should not do it full screen. I think I should just keep it. Oh no. PowerPoint sucks. Always messes you up. Now? It's Microsoft, I say. They don't let you. Okay, so let's switch on to the slide. Yes, so as you saw a little bit on the trailer, what we showed glimpses, there are a lot of characters we have. We have about 40 characters in the game. Each of them have a unique weapon. It's just killing a lot of zombies. So at any point in the screen, it starts off slowly. We might have maybe 20, 30 zombies on the screen. And as you progress in the game, on the, you know, single session, we have capped it at 500 zombies in the screen. So you can, so it's like a Pied Piper game. You are leading the zombies to follow you. You can kill them either using the environment or using your personal weapon. So every character has got a personal weapon. Some might have a dragon, some might have all the different stuff what is there. Everything what you saw on each of those screens is all physics simulated. So everything is happening via physics. That's one thing which is very important. We knew it from day one. We wanted like full physics simulation on the game. So right from the effects to the zombies to the reactions to their death, lot of particle systems and lot of everything is designed under physics. And we wanted it like to react to the environment. The environments are huge. They are almost 100 by 100 units. And every time you play a session and you end a session, we immediately after that when you do a retry, we completely throw you in a different world. So there is. So we wanted to make sure also there are fast loading times in between levels. There should not be like it's almost about 2.5 seconds. So a lot of serialization happening over there as well. Three platforms we supported: iOS, Android, and PC. Next week, iOS and Android will release. Steam, the store page is up. We plan to ship it to Steam by end of the month. That's the plan. We're doing all the controller support and stuff on that. And yes, so the most important question always comes, right? Okay, how many game objects did you have? How are you structurizing it? How are you doing? How are you managing everything? How about memory? How about performance? So the critical question comes is, we did push in tens and thousands of game objects in the screen. So that's no barrier. It's all about how you're structuring and pooling them, and that's important. So they're all animating. Everything is getting animated. So nothing like, there's not a still, right from the environment to the every single zombie on the screen, even to every blood particle, everything is animating. And that's something which we wanted to like create from the essence of the game, what's there. Everything is, as I said, is physics simulation, so everything has got a rigid body. Everything is, so we do a lot of cool stuff with that, but everything is physics simulation. Massive animating environment. You use the environment to kill the zombies. That's how the game is. So it's fun to like, you run them over by a train, a plane, a lot of stuff in the environment. So all of them is on in the environment. So we'll little bit talk about how we created some of the environments and stuff. And obviously crazy destructive physics. And you see all the green blood in the game. It's all, every single cube, it's voxel art, right? So every single disintegration of that zombie, when we kill it, we divide it into a number of individual cubes. Every single cube is a rigid body. Reason of doing that is we could spill it in a way. So if you're throwing a zombie, it's going to like leave its shed of blood. It's going to disintegrate on when it's flying, when it's run over by a train, it disintegrates. Every physics, how the force is applied, is all calculated dynamically. So it gets you that dynamic appeal, which a particle system wouldn't, but if a well-designed, pooled physics effects would do it for you. So that's something which we pushed for. So how do you structure? That's one of the key questions we always have, right? How do you structure it? And how did we go about? This was a very challenging project for us as well. We have never pushed ourselves to create so many objects on the screen and all animating. And it's an arcade game, right? The main essence was to make sure there are no less blood in the screen. You like to like disintegrate the zombies as many as possible. So let's look into how we went about it. So, thumb rule, as you all have guys have used Unity before, golden rule, least number of materials. One major caveat on that, which I'll showcase after I think the next slide, I will get into the project, I'll show you guys, is how we structured all the game objects on the screen. This is very critical. It's just not about putting everything into a single material on this thing, because if you're doing, say, so you have materials, and then after that you're going to apply light over your entire environment, right? And moment you switch on light, it is going to completely change how batching is done internally. Completely, it completely changes. So if you have even say 10 boxes on the screen and all is using one material and you have 4 lights, depending on how the light, where it is placed and which object is affecting, your it'll break down, it'll not do a single batch. It'll break it out into your four lights, what's there. Or even more, depending on two lights, how what your rendering pipeline is set to. So that's something to be taken care of. How do I then make sure all my game objects are in least number of materials, but they also have to get affected by light in a very serialized order so that you make sure you have lesser number of set pass calls. Set pass calls is the most, meaning that's the number you need to look at. For us, so set pass, a golden thumb rule, right? So when we went to low end devices, say we have gone as low as iPhone 4S, you've tested it on, iPhone 4S is a beautiful device, I don't consider it very low end actually. But on Android, we did on some Samsung tabs and stuff like that. But what we made sure is your set pass call shouldn't go more than 30. And anything over 30 is going to be criminal. Like, you're going to like, and Android is notorious for its fragmentation of devices, right? So we had about almost six configurations of how in runtime we could like up and down the graphics fidelity of the game. So on iPhone 4S and all the really low end, we used to like treat the materials differently. So every time the game starts, it actually checks the platform. We have a lot of checks. We use the system info call. We check RAM, we check VRAM, we check what OpenGL version you're running, what is your graphics vendor you're running, what is your shader version number, what is, meaning tons. I literally capture every single thing from system info, whatever it's going to give me, and then break it down and figure to classify them into six buckets. All the handsets. And then what we do is, as the materials are very important, we then iterate through all the materials whenever the level starts, before we get in, we iterate through all the materials stuff, and we decide what shaders it needs to use. If there are some objects which are using some materials, I don't want to apply them some different materials to like get down to improve my performance, I will do that. So all of that is done. It's a simple loop. But we analyze everything. We change the shaders of the material. We change how the rendering is going to happen, how the lights are going to be configured, some of the post-processing effects what we have on the stack, how those are going to be changed, everything depending on these six buckets. So that's very critical. I said, so the set pass calls on a kind of like a mid-range, it'll go about say 100 to 150. And on the high end, we go really high. So on iPhone 6 onwards, we go up to 300 set pass calls. And on maybe iPhone 7s, we go up to almost 350, 400. And on iPhone 8s and onwards, we go main. More than almost 700, 800 set pass calls. So we really up the amp on that. And on PC, PC is no different than mobile because some of the PC configurations are really sad. So you need to like make aware of them as well. But what we have done is we have obviously an ultra high for the PC to render it at full 4K. So we make sure it runs at full 4K as well. And so that has a different configuration at the end. There we go, set pass calls are about, I mean, it depends on some of the configurations, how we lit them, it goes to even in thousands. So it's 1,000 and 2,000 set pass calls is what we have noticed. So those are the brief numbers on that. Second, obviously, is the pooling. How many of you guys use pooling? Yeah. Awesome. Thanks to you guys. It's something which is very important, right? Pooling is, if you're not using them, please use them, because if you pooling is very useful when you have, if you want performance. If you want performance, you need to do pooling. It helps you in memory, it helps you everywhere, right? And that's something which, so all our in-game stuff is all on pooling, right from the zombies, even the zombies, how, there are different types of zombies in the game. So everyone have their own pool to render over here, and then recycle it. So pooling is important. This really helped us to really, if you design the pooling well, you could scale it up very easily. So you can like suddenly say like, now I have to just in one place in my code, I have to just say like, hey, I want the cap to be 10,000 zombies, and it'll just work. It automatically dynamically creates the pool for every single everyone else, and it just works like that. So pooling is the best friend. There's something unique with it, the four light system, as we call it. We called it internally. This is which I'll show in the next, I'll show it in the code as well. This is something which we created, and it really enhanced the visual of the game. How many of you guys use real-time lights in your games? Very few. That's precisely the reason. Another meaning, how many of you guys don't use a light because of performance issues? Yeah, the hands are coming more up. Yeah, so that's a tough thing, right? Light is expensive, meaning however way you put at it. But I'll tell you one thing: if you do it little tricks, if you take care, you will be able to achieve the four light system. We have tested, so we have dynamic lighting from iPhone 6 onwards. So iPhone 6 is almost 3 years old, but it's a pretty good device. So on Android, we might go up to, say, anything which has 4 cores and a decent enough GPU, we switch on lighting, dynamic lighting as well. Obviously, for the low end, we switch it off. We do have lights, but we do a vertex lit pipeline for it. So it just computes all the lights, and in one pass, it just renders it. But the main thing is from the light system is how we have structured them with regards to the environment, as well as respecting the materials are not broken down as well, right? Because you have to take care of the set pass calls. You switch on one point light on the game, and you are rendering everything as set pass calls. It's going to zoom. It's going to show you 300, 400, 500, 600. It depends how many game objects. Every game object is going to receive light. Cull the light, there are a lot of stuff which is happening. So the four light system is precisely like how we used single light sources, applied it on different layers, and obviously grouped them into different materials itself. I'll talk a little about it later. GPU, again, GPU should be under 30 milliseconds for any device. You're then only going to get consistent 30 FPS in your game. It should be, if it's lower than that, it's even better. But that number is really important on profiling. So if you make sure your GPU is good under 30 milliseconds, I think you should be good enough. And to achieve how much you load, you can put on the GPU, you have to decide from a game what component should use the CPU and what should use the GPU. We'll come back to that also later, but this is what we have made sure like the number stands. Massive environment, animating environment. Everything uses an animator. We have about hundreds of animators running on the scene, hundreds. Everything is an animator. Our entire UI FX is all animator. Okay, we use an animator. It really helps. UI specifically, how many of you guys use animator for UI? Yeah, it's awesome, right? It helps in porting. You don't have to really worry about, how is it going to scale? How my hinges are going to happen and stuff. So unless if you're using, say, a lean tween or something to tween it, you're always going to have porting issues on different resolutions. But an animator just takes care of it. That's the beauty. So all our UI in all our games, we end up using an animator. So it really helps in your porting stages as well. And you can do really cool stuff with it. So there's a lot of collision happening in the game. So make sure your CPU specifically is free for physics. And when the mobile platforms, everything goes on the CPU. So your physics is going to hog your CPU. And since we have a lot of physics stuff in your game, you are going to so you have to keep it free. So when I say keep it free, you need to really make sure the rest of the stuff are either, meaning properly designed using coroutines, you execute them, all your logic, all your other heavy duty stuff, what you're querying for the environment and stuff there, keep it over there. We do not push even some of the rendering calculations. We try to put some of the calculations on the GPU, so you can still do that as well. So keep the CPU free for physics. That's extremely important. Why is it going to help you? Is because if you want to use PostFX. How many of you guys use a PostFX stack? Okay, very few. So do use them. One is, yes, it is expensive, it's but you could do really cool stuff, right, with it. And if you have a GPU relatively free, if you're not reaching those 30 millisecond milestone, so you can switch on a lot of your PostFX stack, and you could do even more cooler stuff on your rendering process as well. So keep that in mind. So as I said, the look of the game, right? It ultimately comes down to the look. Okay, the game is fun, the logic is good, but how do I just make it, take it to a 10 steps more higher? How do I make sure it looks beautiful, the light sources and stuff? It's all with lights and shadows. And every single object is going to really, like even in this scene, there are four lights on it. Everything has got a light source. Everything is dynamic. We didn't want anything to be like static. And this is all because of the four light system what we have in. So we use the pixel light rendering for all kind of from mid-end to high-end. That's something which is there. We use the pixel light quality. We use four pixel lights because we are locked to four lights. So we want every object, if it can afford to have four lights, you please do it. You get affected by four lights on the screen. So if you get the number down, what Unity is going to do is, it's going to then try to switch off one light source. If you set the light source, you're like, oh, hey, do it only with the two pixel light counts. It's going to calculate it for any two lights, which it feels depending on certain parameters. So if you set a light system to like, hey, I'm going to use four, just so that I don't want any bad light switching off scenarios in the game, what's there. So you can make sure like all the high end. So this from iPhone 7 onwards, everything goes across iPhone 7, 8, all your high end stuff, you have kept the four pixel light on. Okay, so it's beautiful on that. So it's every, you'll see a single character having a red hue, an environmental hue on it, different. It looks very beautiful. Any effects is happening, we switch on a light. So there's a green blood, we switch on a green light. And like, so there are all different colors coming on your body. And nowadays, there are a lot of tablets on, a lot of people game on these tablets. So it's very important, like, and if you like, we are demoing on the floor on an iPad Pro, the latest. It's a freaking big device, and it gives away a lot. If you're like not doing your lighting and stuff like properly, it'll kind of give away a lot of stuff. So you need to make sure like, one, your high end is on four, and it really will help you on your rendering quality, what's there. On iPhone 6 onwards, anything below that, there's a big large pool, right? Right, your iPhone 6, even your 5S for that matter. But we have safely have kept it at iPhone 6 onwards is on one pixel light. That means it does your pixel lighting, but it will do it on any one. So it's just going to calculate on one. This is also really good enough. The performance is really nice. So this will at least enable if you have that pixel lighting system instead of the vertex lit. What's there? On low end, we go vertex lit. On low end, it's completely on. So there are lights sources which are there, but they all calculated and averaged out in one and into one single calculation. And then use vertex lit just then apply it on vertices. So it's not going to be really nice, but we make sure like every device, at least we go on a vertex lit system. At least that is, that ambience is not left out, what you've designed on the light. So we go, so you can switch on all these things directly programmatically from the code. As we said, we have those six configurations, you can do that. Most important, shadows. Shadows is what will give you depth in your game for any 3D game, right? And in this game, we use zero real-time shadows. Shadows are expensive. Shadows, unless you have lesser number of objects, you're showing it very close to the scene, you should switch it on. As I said, you have to look at your GPU. What is it consuming? Is it already reached 30 milliseconds where it can maybe afford shadows? In our case, we had tens and thousands of objects. Every single zombie has got a shadow. Every single bullet what he fires from the gun, we render a shadow on the ground. It's that effect, it's that art treatment what we have done. Anything on the art, everything, the shadow is kind of, so the, all the occlusion layers and stuff like that, everything, we have created L-shaped shadows and stuff like that, and we've stuck it in the environment. So it's all fake. But what it effectively does is, you can, all the shadows are all onto a single material. all one material, and there is no light which will get affected on it. So what happens is you have these tens and thousands of shadows, and they will all render in one single call. In a single call, everything gets rendered. That's pretty important. On shadow specifically, switching on lighting is going to kill your performance, because it's going to break your materials, it's going to grate, it creates a big havoc. So I would recommend you put all your shadows in a single. So even if you have different types of shadows, you bake them on a single texture, and you create prefabs then out of adjusting the UVs, and then you can place them in the environment. That's what we have done. We have baked, so some of the houses and some of the stuff that we have, like different L-shaped shadows and stuff like that, and then we have done it in that way. So one shadow material, and with instancing, how many of you guys switch on the instance on the materials? Okay, so that's something to take away. I think no one has done that. So it's the last property when you scroll down endlessly on the materials. It says enable instancing. There's a small little text which says it. That thing is magic. Okay, I would like you guys to go out and try it out today, if possible. So what's going to happen is, also you have something called as material instancing. What's it going to do? It's going to try to batch any object which is using that material into a single call. But for that, what it sacrifices is, it sacrifices your, it cannot be statically batched, and it shouldn't be dynamically batched as well. There should be no batching on it. That's the trade-off. So if you enable batching on that game object, and you switch on your instancing on the material, it's not going to do it. It's going to say, hey, it's not possible. So what you should do is, you should try not to do batching on it at all, just switch it off, but enable this instancing on the material, and you'll see a huge performance boost, especially if you have that material affecting a lot of objects. And this is what is going to be that magic button, what's going to be there. And so with instancing enabled, depending on different materials, how they are, so you guys have to like see, is static batching going to give me more performance on the CPU? This is also going to give me performance on CPU as GPU, right? It's materials. It's going to like batch it, it's going to render it also all at once. It's going to give you a boost in CPU as well as GPU as well. So you'll have to take a call on what you want to be static batched. If no, then go with the instancing of the shadow material. What's there? Okay, before we hit that, let's see whether I can. Okay, I'll have to exit the full screen mode. Okay. Okay, just let's run the game and let's pause it in some point, and we'll analyze, we'll see some of the stuff what's there. I'm going to mute the sound for now. Okay, it's really tiny. Okay. Let's play about for maybe 20 seconds. Let's gather some zombies. Okay, slowly appearing. So there is, on the left top side corner, there is a count of how many zombies are there. I'm not going to pick up that bull for now. I'm just going to get as many zombies as possible and try not to kill them. So they need to be alive as well. Screwed, sorry. We have the magic of gems. That's what happened. A developer sucks at his own games. There are a lot of cool effects happening when it zooms in. I'll talk about that as well, how, what all we did during the post-processing stack. Okay, we have about 20 of them. There are some green blood. Let's pause. I'm going to zoom out, so let's see. There are too many game objects, so I'm just going to. Okay, so what we have over here, let me just get rid of that as well. Okay, so we have a couple of zombies. We have about 20 of them each. I will try to see. So what we do is, another thing is, every zombie has got its own scripts and everything. It talks to itself. It's going to figure out how am I going to die. It's going to figure out how I'm going to going to be killed by a tank or by this bus or this plane. It's going to send out that information to the logic system. It figures it out. And everyone has got a rigid body onto it, and there are some physics scripts as well on it, which will allow to hey, do I die being a low-end device or do I die being a high-end device? It talks. Everything is in that script, in that container. It's not centrally controlled. That's how the architecture is. One advantage of that is you can just apply those scripts to anyone, any prefabs, what's there. And since it all contains, not centrally controlled, but you're going to have a lot of scripts updating. So what I do is, they usually check for every second. So we don't do any check. So it only checks all of its logic and everything, whatever the scripts are running. So there are thousands of scripts running, because they're all prefabs and they're running at all period of time. But we'll make sure they're only checking every second. And not all zombies. What we do is, we initialize a random timer at the beginning of when your zombie is alive or any of FX is alive, and so they will check. Maybe one guy might check at the 50th second, one guy might check at the 52nd second, one might check at the 32nd. So it depends on that pool. So what that helps is, in a single frame, maybe there are only 5 zombies which have been calculated. What I've seen in the testing and cells, so every frame there is a different calculation. Sometimes the zombie is being checked, sometimes one of the physics effects of the bodies is being checked, the blood is being checked. So everything is not happening all at once in one single frame, but they are all scattered and I have no clue about it. But in 1 second, everyone will get calculated. That's the only golden rule. So that's something which really helps in performance as well, because you're checking not everything in one single frame, what's there. Okay, so if you see, a little better. All are rendering. Now, this is the advantage of being a voxel-based game, right? You don't have to have a really large texture. That texture size is about, 64 by 64. And whatever you saw rendering on that screen in the game is all happening through that one single texture on that. So it's a band. How many of you guys have used Magicka Voxel? Awesome, right? Awesome tool. So we use Magicka Voxel ourselves for everything. What's there built in the game is built either in Magicka Voxel, and we have used some in 3D Studio Max as well for anything which we couldn't get it over there. But or else, even all the animations, everything is done on Magicka Voxel. So a single banded texture is going to give you almost all the color palette what we needed. We chose these colors and we're like, hey, these are the color palettes what we need. So it's all embedded into that single texture and bands in different gradiencies. And then we are mapping them on every single block of that voxel character using that. And what we have done over here as well is, one is the graphic instancing is on all the zombies, if you notice that as well. And if you go at the top, there is no batching happening on this. Okay, so there is no dynamic batching happening on this. We disable dynamic batching specifically because we don't want to accidentally, so anything under 200 polygons, Unity is automatically going to convert into dynamic batching if you keep it on. So we disable it for this game specifically, because it will break your material GPU instancing. It will break the material. So switch off dynamic instancing, but you kept the static batching on for different stuff. What's there? So this is going to really help you on that. Another on the light as well. Let me try to, okay. So as we were discussing on the line, so we have a lot of stuff divided into scenes when the game is running. So we do additive scening, loading of all. So all the environments are loaded post you know, it's a separate environment, what's there. And let's see where the light stuff is. So we break it down into hierarchy as well, and inside every level we do a check. So we enable disable objects depending on, again, if it's a high end, low end, mid end, all the fragmentation stuff. One very important thing which you have to remember is, like, we have this high end tag on, there are a lot of objects onto it, a lot of cool stuff what is happening inside that, and you have to make sure they are switched off when you actually start that scene. Where it really helps is if you switch it on and then you say in your code, hey, if it's a low-end or a mid-end device, disable it. Okay, that's not going to help, because what's going to happen is it's going to load the scene and it's then automatically going to initialize the memory for everything that game object requires in, and then it is going to disable it. But by that time, you already lost everything, all the optimizations what's therein. So one major thing, if you're having different setups for low, medium, high end, and stuff like that, make sure they are all disabled so nothing gets loaded. Okay, and once the scene loads, and like you check over there depending on a setting, and then you say, hey, enable this. Enable this, enable this. Unity works really well in managing in that way. So remember that as a check. All the shadows are over here. So whatever orange stuff what you see are all fake shadows, all built in, right from all the occlusion and everything what I was saying is all over here. We do a slight occlusion depending on some of the L shapes and stuff like that. Everything, all the shadows, as I said, one call, you can have tens and thousands of objects as shadows. Every single grass on the screen, blood on screen, everything has got a shadow. But make sure it's, again, as I said, one material and no light affecting it at all. I can see. So what we do over here is we use the unlit transparent shader on it. Works really well. One thing it does, it will not interfere with any of your light passes. So it's going to shut off everything. So it's not going to break your instancing pipeline as well. And simple enough, it's a small texture which will all happen in one shot. And don't worry about the number of game objects you're creating, because Unity is smart enough to like to pull them all together and launch them, so it's okay. So on the coming to the light, so as I said, so the 4-point light system, right? What we use. So it's better. Like, so we have these three special lights, what you see in over here, simple point lights, okay? And then you have obviously one single environment. So we use one single environment light for the entire environment. And how do we achieve all the dynamism in the level? Simple enough. Good old PC trick, you place probes everywhere. So you place an empty game object. So we have an empty game object. All these are environment lights. They all point to different areas of the level on what mood you want to create. So all this fire is having a light source onto it. And there's a simple script which tells you, like, hey, what do we need your light intensity to be? How much range you need to have to affect? And a simple thing is a color. What it's going to do is, when it's going to jump from, as you saw when I was showing you also, when it jumps from one object to the other, we fade in and we fade out. So you will not notice it, or a normal person will not notice it at all. It will fade in, it will then fade out into the other areas. So it illuminated really beautifully. One of the very important thing is the range. The higher the range it's going to be, the more expensive it's going to get, because it's going to try to like lit every the entire area, how much of area you're going to give in. Again, it's an you have to fiddle around with your numbers and to see in, because if you have, say, tens and thousands of game object in a single area, and if you want to like affect it, if you can afford to affect a really small area, get the range lower. It will not affect the other game object on the screen. This is going to really help you in performance as well. So you have to come and balance to your number depending on your scale, or what's a good number to hit at. But that's going to really help in your performance as well. So every single probe, so we have, like, depending on this entire level, it's massive level, we have about, I think it's about 70, 80 light points, and we set the mood of the level on every single area of the level. So suddenly it becomes dark, suddenly it becomes light, suddenly there's a different hue to it. And it's just moving, interpolating between two values. Then we have these the other special lights in the level. What we do is, so some of the dynamic objects, what you saw, there's a rock rolling, there's a tank moving which had a light, you had some other areas as well, some dynamic objects which are lights. So those enable with using these special lights on them. And we directly then give them whatever the game object is there, we just attach it to the object. I don't know if it's there on this, but yeah. Yeah, so, and what we do is, as the thumb rule is there, right, for the 4-point light system. So at any point of time in this, there will be two lights which will be enabled. So either it could be, so it could be a rock moving or say an aeroplane taking off, so that might have a light, and there'll be one environment light to it. So that's a logic which is over and above all of the system. So we'll make sure the environment for all of its lights is using two lights at any point of time. And we override that rule whenever anything inside the game, what is there. So, I don't know, let's go to our zombies and then check. Anything is on. Okay, let's go to our player, it'll be easier to search that way. Oh. And we have this, I don't know whether you saw on the level, we have a mini map as well at the top left. So that's just a static camera and it sculls every single object, but it keeps these markers which you see, that white thing which is there around it. And only that gets enabled at the top. So it helps you to really do a quick mini map system on the top, what's there. So on the zombie itself, so when you look at the light, we have obviously put all the zombies in a separate layer, okay, and we affect the zombies' light only on that layer, what's there. And there are some special shaders which run to make them look more evil. But best is to split up those layers as well and then enable them depending on what zombies is where. So the zombies, everyone, all zombies have a single light source and they have their own shader rendering pipeline. So you have to make sure you layer your game objects as beautifully as possible, as discrete as possible, and then you can enable all the game objects on that as well. Let's see if we can get them. So that's our blood, and yes, it's green in color. Simple unlit. So if you notice the materials as well, all our blood, again, I didn't want the blood to be affected by light. If the moment you're affected by light, it's going to be affecting different lights and it's going to create havoc. Keep as shadows, the blood is also unlit. So you can have like, so my, every single thing is a rigid body, by the way. So whenever it's disintegrating itself and stuff like that, a lot of blood is going to come out on it. And everyone is getting affected by, since it's unlit and there's nothing else going to be affecting it, it's going to all render the entire blood in the level in one single call. And it also has, now for this, we have made sure like it all gets pooled into a single mesh and we render it. That's something which you do internally as well. But you could still avoid it. But main thing is use unlit. Don't let light get affected by these objects. It'll all render it in one single call as well. Just going to try to do that. Okay, it's going to kill itself. Okay, so this is the butcher level. So you see all of those ground and everything, all of those are animators. All the rolling stuff, there is, you saw all of them getting killed and blood being released, all of that is physics. You could, so we freeze the frame, you could take screenshots. So it's all using the frame buffer. You can optimize it really fast to do. Everything pauses. Thanks to the new versions of Unity, everything, even the physics get affected by time scale. So we just enable time scale on this. You could take a quick, really fast screenshot and then share it. Really viral, really helps onto it. But the good thing is even physics now gets affected by time scale and it works smoothly. Earlier it used to be a lot more jerkier, but now it's not. I'll try. I'm trying. Okay, that's a train passing by. So run away from it. Run away from it. So you saw the light and the light flickering. So every area you go in, there's a little bright level. So like the lampposts are lit, and then they fade off, and maybe the next lamppost might lit again. So there's a fade in, fade out effect. There's a particular range on what's there. Let's try to collect the ball. And when you use a ball, you'll go through different stuff. What's there and there are a lot of game objects. Thanks to pooling, all the blood what you see, all the game objects being created is all pooled. So it's already there, it's already instanced. I'm just like trying to like get it mapped and come onto the game, and they're there. So because of pooling, and one very important thing which I want to share, I just completely forgot about it, is the most physics calculation when you want to disintegrate something, right? The most expensive operation is not the physics reaction. That's kind of literally free. The main problem comes in when you have to solve, if you look at the profile of the physics itself, so if you have objects touching each other, okay, or maybe intersecting each other, and then you say apply a rigid body reaction to it, that's expensive. That brings a huge spike. Even if you take, say, 10 cubes, take 10 cubes, try to intersect them a little bit together, okay, and then say apply an explosion force to it. You will see a big spike saying like the physics is trying to solve how to separate them from each other, so they don't touch each other. That calculation and stuff is really expensive, okay. And then what it's going to do, after it has separated them, push them a little bit apart, then it'll apply the reaction. Okay, and that reaction, when you see it in a profiler, the reaction, what it applies is literally negligible. But the spike, what you see is the time taken for it to solve that physics problem of separating those bodies, getting them out, cleaning them, and then moving across. So one neat trick what we did over here is whenever we are releasing the blood, when you are taking the zombie shape of those cubes, we give a small spacing on those cubes, okay. It's not visible at all. So we give a small spacing, so all the cubes are not touching each other. Hey, don't touch me. It's literally that way. And what that does is basically it completely removes the entire physics solving calculation of, you know, pushing them apart. That calculation completely goes off. And that really helps, because when you're switching on instantly a physics and it has to solve it, and tens and thousands of blood is just being created, it's really expensive. So that's a trick to remember. Just make sure they're a little apart. If you can afford to do that on the physics part, separate that, and then you can apply your physics stuff. The second thing what we do is, I don't know whether it's there. Okay. Sorry, I have to go to and die. Another important thing is default when you set up the physics system out there, the time step is set to 0.02. That really literally means it's going to, it sets how many times your physics update is called, how many times your collisions are called, depending on what you have set them as. Continuous, dynamic, discrete, and all of that stuff, right? So some of the stuff, we all are zombies and everyone are all on continuous dynamic. The blood is on continuous dynamic. We have to like, so that we have that cool little effect. It just doesn't intersect in bodies and stuff like that all. But one thing what we do is we dynamically change this value internally. So when I have to show a lot of blood, I need a lot of performance, I need to make a lot of accuracy, we get it down to 0.01. So what will 0.01 do? It'll obviously increase the time given on your fixed time, your calculations and stuff like that. But really, it's almost like doubling your calculations. But it'll give you a much smoother performance. It'll give you a much smoother calculations. Everything look much more cleaner, okay? But at the cost of CPU. Okay, so you have to keep profiling your CPU time as well. How many milliseconds are you at? And if you can afford it, change this to 0.01 is what I would recommend. 0.01, it really helps in all your calculations. It becomes much more smoother and cooler, your physics systems out there. So you can do that dynamically as well. You don't need to like always keep it at that value. So change it according to different scenarios in your game. What's there? Okay. I'm going to go back to the slide. Okay. So on the physics itself, now every single of the particles is actually also physics. So we'll come down to that. So as I showed, there are lot of rigid bodies. So don't shy away from them. It works. You can put tens and thousands of rigid bodies. Just make sure these small little things what you can take care. We already set on the time scale update for physics. Greenwald blocks is. We change the quality of it depending on, again, those six buckets what we created. So some of them will listen to, will have many boxes. Some of them will have lesser. Low end will have only, I think, two boxes per zombies. So there's still blood, there's still physics, but we really scale it down as well. So that really helps us to control that quality what's there. And they're lit differently as well. So on the low end, we do a different lighting. On we need a glowy green color post effects also onto it. So they're all shaded differently. All the bodies collide with the environment. So that really looks cool, right? If it's a very physics-based game, everything needs to interact, else it's no fun. So that's something which is enabled, but your CPU time at the cost. As I said, keep looking at the profiler on that. We pool all the physics, we cull all the physics as well. So when I'm saying cull, what we do is whatever is on the scene will have their rigid bodies enabled. Okay, rest everything switches off. Okay, there are like hundreds of zombies up outside the screen as well. They're all coming and chasing you. So we do two things. In the game, if you notice, we use nav mesh. So entire pathfinding is on nav mesh. And what we do is then we apply different behaviors to different zombies. We calculate, we tweak the paths in various different ways to make them feel dumb. So there's a cute little AI which runs and figures out how it's going to like move around. But that's what we're going to use on that. So on the culling of the physics objects, what's going to happen is even the environment will shut down a lot of stuff when you're not there in that screen buffer. And now if you look at that effect, when it goes zooms in, there's a lot of depth of field effect and stuff like that which happens to showcase hero that moment. So during that point of time as well, we all the physics nearby is all on and everything else is all shut off from away from it. So you have to like kind of little balance. This will really help not on the high end, it'll help really on the mid end and low end. That's where it helps to cull everything as much as possible. Thank you. I'm ready for Q&A.
Thank you, guys.
Sure.
With what I guessed, your zombies work on physics
anyway. Right.
You are not actually using the animator, you are just applying physics.
On the zombies? Yeah, the zombies actually have a. They have three frame animations. They are actually only meshes. They're not even skinned. Yeah. So it's just we don't even enable disable them. We scale them. So to show a particular frame.
So that was the question actually. Sure. We are using skinned mesh.
Skinned is expensive. Yeah.
We could only get maximum of 70 zombies.
So I've done a profile. I actually on the iPhone, like for the high end and low end stuff. But apart from doing on your code is really criminal. And so what we do, instead of that do scaling. What we do, so the three frame animation and you just switch the scale on what frame it needs to render at that particular point. And then it's just, and since everything is on a single material, it really doesn't matter. So there is no performance lost at all onto it. But don't use skinned. Skinned, unless, like for such games, you can get away by not doing skinned. Skin mesh. Skin mesh is really expensive. And the second is if you switch on GPU skinning, you're going to use away a lot of GPU time as well. So it's better like to avoid it.
Yeah. One more thing. You said that you use Animator for UI.
Yes.
But what we found was that instead handling UI with coroutines was much more cheaper.
Right. So I would kind of disagree to that. The reason being, we use a lot of animators on, like all the thing is on an animator. And trust me, it's a zero performance call. It manages, it threads beautifully, it's multi-threading, so it works really well for all your cores. Even on a low end, there's no problem at all. So, and the best thing is, you could give it to an artist, and he will animate it. So I don't have, like, even in a score bulging or when the stamina is low or even the UI stuff, how things are all created, my animator can set up different states and tell like, hey, call this when you're at this particular health, call this or when you have done such a score. And everything, he wires it inside. I don't have to do anything. My artist is continuously wiring those animators. That gives them the flexibility as well, helps you in both cases. Yeah.
Thanks.
Good. Anyone else?
If I say that, they're going to die anyway because they are over there, and I move away.
Right.
Wouldn't that stop me from scoring that person?
So what will happen is you'll have to smartly disable it. So that is a safety area as well, where anything what the user sees is what he's going to believe, right? Yeah. If you're moving forward, I don't want my zombies to die with the train when it's 10 feet away from me. That kills the gameplay. It's a conscious choice as well. We didn't want it to be built into the gameplay experience, but it's all about that. What you see is what you're killing. And rest everything can be disabled is what the call we took, and really doesn't matter when you're frantically. It's such an immersive game where you're playing it. You really don't have to think about that. It worked for us actually. Okay, thanks guys. I'll not take too much time. If there's anything, I'll be out over here as well as on our booth. Please do check it out. Check out the game. Thanks guys.
Hey, thanks.